My name is Hortensia Soto, and I'm a professor at Colorado State University. I was not always good at math, and I'm not sure I would even say I'm good at math. I will say that I love it. I find it fun. It's like a little puzzle, and it actually has taken a lot of work for me. I always say the only reason I'm good at it, if that's the word we're using, is because I've practiced it. I mean, starting in high school, math was really my dessert homework. It was the last thing I wanted to do, so I could spend a lot of time on it. And I won't lie, I always say that starting in ninth grade, I spent 3 hours a night doing math homework, and all through college, and of course through grad school, probably more, definitely more. So no, it didn't come easy to me. It was fun work. I really enjoyed that. So I always thought I would be a lawyer growing up. That's what I wanted to do because I thought lawyers are going to make money. And of course, I was encouraged to pursue something in mathematics by my high school math teacher, but I thought, ugh, I don't know. But I was always tutoring, and in college, I took Calc 1. I was a political science major because that was the route to then become a lawyer, I guess. And I went into my advisor after the first semester, and I said, well, I'm going to take Calc 2 the second semester. And he said, well, you don't need Calc 2. You've already satisfied the math requirement with Calc 1. And I said, no, but we didn't finish the book. And he just laughed and he said, don't you think you should be a math major? And without missing a beat, I said, yeah, that is what I want to do. Just like that. It was just so clear to me right there and then that that's what I loved. So I'm a mathematics educator. I explore the teaching and learning of undergraduate mathematics, and I've done lots and lots of various works in different areas. And right now I'm concentrating on complex analysis, which I am really enjoying. And the part that I really want to focus on is the lens that I use. So I use this lens called embodied cognition. And so my work really is an intersection between mathematics, education, and cognition. So the psychology behind it, how the brain works, how we think about thinking. And so embodied cognition is really this philosophy that learning is body-based, so that our body knows things before we can even convey them. And so that's kind of this philosophy of how can I create, engage, pay attention to the body movements that my students make that tell me how they're conveying mathematics. And so it's really helping to help students recognize that they know more than that they know, but that they're not ready to articulate it for whatever reason, although their body begins to convey those ideas. And so in my teaching and in my research, because for me, those go hand in hand, they feed one another, I use gesture and body movement as a source of evidence to tell me what students might be thinking, what I hypothesize that they are thinking. And in my teaching, I pay attention to their gestures. And I say, put your pencils down and look at my hands, because I'm going to convey something intentionally with intentional gestures. And I create environments where they have to move in a particular way in order to explore a mathematical concept. I will say that up through the time I got my master's, I don't think I had any real struggles. I mean, did I find it difficult? Yes, but I had a great cohort of friends and we worked together. And when I got to grad school, it was like, oh my gosh, some of these people already had a PhD in another country. Most of them had gone to very, very prestigious schools, and I lost my confidence. Like day one, I was just terrified. I got really sick. I started having heart issues even at that time. I just had no confidence whatsoever. I just felt dumb. And and nobody was reaching across the aisle to say, how can we help you? We want you to succeed. That was really hard for me. So then found another program, and I really, again, went in just feeling like a bug. That's how I felt, just smaller than a bug and so dumb. I'm like, do I not know anything? I know I used to know this stuff, but nothing would really come to me. And then I transferred to a different school because I didn't pass one of the qualifying exams. And so, because I thought I would get a PhD at that one school. And so I went to another school and I met with, I guess he was the graduate chair. And he looked at the list of courses I'd had. I came in with all the books, the texts, because I'm like, I don't know if these texts are good enough. They're probably going to say they're not good enough texts. And he just laughed and he's like, wow, you have a really strong math background. You're perfect for us. And I'm just so grateful for that person, because that day I just had a little bit of hope that maybe one day I would get a PhD. And I was at a place that was very supportive, and it was a much better fit for me. It was a really good fit for me. And I was doing what I wanted to do. I wanted to learn how to do research in math ed. I was not learning how to do that. I was being trained to be a mathematician, which I figured out I still am. But I was being trained to do research in something else that I did not want to do research in. So it was not a good fit in that sense. Surprisingly, when I went to this next school, all of a sudden I realized, wow, I did learn a lot of math at that school where I was really suffering. So, I mean, I learned a lot there. It was just really dehumanizing, demoralizing. In our careers, as in academia, we're assessed on scholarship, we're assessed on teaching, we're assessed on service. And interestingly enough, I have three things that I'm most proud of, and they're all related. They fall into each of one of those categories. In terms of scholarship, I'm really proud of how I contributed to the MAA Instructional Practices Guide. And I truly believe that my expertise and knowledge and familiarity with the research in mathematics education helped bring that package together and just bring that document together. So I'm really proud that I have been part of that project in terms of scholarship. In terms of teaching, I received the MAA HAMO TAPO Teaching Award. So that was a huge, huge thing for me. So I'm really proud of that. And then in terms of service, I'm really proud to be the first woman associate secretary of the MAA, the first Hispanic, and the first mathematics educator in this role. So I'm very proud of that. So it doesn't surprise me that most of these things are all associated with Mathematical Association of America. But really, overall, in terms of my entire life, the thing that I am most proud of is the relationship that I have with my son. But really, just being his mom, that's the best thing in life. I have been fortunate, blessed, and just grateful that I've had numerous role models in my life. My teachers have been wonderful role models, because they've taught me how important it is to be kind, and that's what I want. That those are the role models that I want. Not how do you be the best mathematician, but how can you really be the best person? How can you be a better person? And we immigrated here to the U.S. So I didn't know English. My dad, we came here with $7, my mom, my dad, and me and my sister to the U.S. And So if I really had to pick who are my best role models, I would have to say they are my parents. They taught me the value of work, and they taught me the value of gratitude. You know, through their stories, they would always share how people helped us. Strangers, the town we moved into, people would just show up with hand-me-down clothes for all of us. And those are really good people. They're farmers in Morrill, Nebraska. They're teachers in Morrill, Nebraska. They're neighbors in Morrill, Nebraska. The Dynases, just everyday people who really extend their hand out to others and really open doors that they don't even know that they're opening. Hold the door open for you and walk you through. Those are the role models in my life. I think for me, it's like lots of things, but one, pay attention. Pay attention to how you're being treated, how you're experiencing events, how you feel about those events. And it's really easy to be angry about it, like I was for a long time, and embarrassed and try to hide if you're hurt by something. And then just ask yourself, how can I be different? How can I do things differently for others? Or if you experience joy and somebody does something really good for you, it's like, wow, how can I do this for others? And so I would just say, how can you aspire to inspire others? What good little deeds can you do to help? What little acts of kindness can you do to help somebody feel included, feel nurtured, feel a sense of belonging, feel as they're part of the community? And also recognize that it's not always easy. It's unfortunately, or fortunately, I think maybe it's fortunately, because I think those are where the big lessons come. But that there's always, always somebody there to help, always.